Hello everyone. In this video, we'll talk about urea cycle regulation. Forget about urea cycle for a moment. If we talk about regulation of any metabolic pathway, then the regulation can occur at several levels and at several time scales. For example, there could be regulations by modulating the enzyme activity, which are necessary for that pathway. There could be epigenetic modulation, transcriptional level modulation, and there could be also modulation of protein stability, that how much time the protein is staying in an active conformation. All of these things can be a factor that regulates a biochemical pathway. Maybe combination of these strategies could be used to regulate a biochemical pathway. And all of these strategies range from several minutes to several hours. So let us look at, if we talk about urea cycle, What are these strategies for regulation? So, scientists pointed out that contents of the urea cycle enzymes in the liver were directly proportional to the daily consumption of protein. That means an individual who is consuming low protein diet versus high protein diet, in them, the urea cycle regulation would be very different, right? And the enzyme levels or the enzyme activities would be also different. Moreover, during starvation, these urea cycle enzymes are very important because during starvation, a lot of protein gets degraded into amino acids and the carbon skeleton is used to generate glucose, whereas the ammonia or the amine group need to be excreted because it is extremely toxic. That is why regulation of urea cycle is necessary. When we talk about urea cycle regulation, it can occur broadly into two different levels, and at least these two levels we are going to talk about now. Now, first of all, there could be transcriptional control, there could be allosteric control. In transcriptional control, the transcripts of urea cycle enzymes can be modulated. So the cells can modulate how many transcript would be produced under that certain metabolic circumstances. Now, in case of allosteric regulation, the enzymes which are necessary for urea cycle or the rate limiting enzymes, they could be modulated in an allosteric fashion, right? But the difference between these type of possible control is the time scale. The allosteric control is a short term modulation happening in order of minutes to seconds, whereas the transcriptional control is occurring at several minutes to even hours. So transcriptional control is way slower than allosteric control. Depending upon the need and necessity, these kind of strategies would be followed by the body. So let us try to understand the amino acid catabolism in bit more details to understand the regulation of urea cycle. So when amino acids are broken down, they would be funneled into glutamate, and all of their amine group would be donated to glutamate. Now, glutamate would eventually get converted to alpha-ketoglutarate and it would release the ammonia. Now, this ammonia being toxic, it has to be converted to a less toxic form. And this is urea. So, the urea cycle ensures that the harmful ammonia is now converted to urea, which is less harmful and can be excreted. So, the first process is known as transamination. Then, forming ammonia is known as deamination from glutamate. And urea cycle is the process by which urea is excreted. So this chain of these processes are important for amino acid catabolism. If you need to understand amino acid catabolism in bit more details, you can click on the link in the description or in the I button. So guys, the first step of urea cycle is conversion of ammonia into carbamoyl phosphate, and then in a subsequent step, ornithine is converted to citrulline, then several intermediates are there in the process, and ultimately from arginine, urea is generated. So let us review the first step, which is the rate limiting step and the slowest step in this whole metabolic pathway. So carbamoyl phosphate synthetase triggers the synthesis of carbamoyl phosphate from ammonia and bicarbonate. Now this is a rate limiting step because it occurs very slowly and this can be regulated. So you can understand if this rate limiting step is positively or negatively regulated, then there could be changes in the output or the flux through this urea cycle. In a negative regulation, no carbamoyl phosphatase would be generated. As a result, the urea cycle events would be totally shut down. While in case of positive modulation, a lot of carbamoyl phosphate would be generated, and as more carbamoyl phosphates are generated, the urea cycle would run and it would excrete a hell lot of urea. So be it a positive modulation, be it a negative modulation, let us look at how it is regulated. So N-acetyl glutamate is a positive modulator for carbamoyl phosphate synthetase 1 or CPS1. So it positively regulates the forward reaction. Moreover, N-acetyl glutamate is generated from glutamate and acetyl CoA with the help of the enzyme N-acetyl glutamate synthase. Let me tell you that N-acetyl glutamate synthase is also regulated by L-arginine. So if you have more arginine, more of these enzymes would be produced, and the end result would be positive modulation of carbamoyl phosphate synthetase. So in that way, urea cycle can be regulated. So I hope this video was clear. If you enjoyed this video, give it a quick thumbs up. Don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Thank you. And do let me know in the comments how do you like my videos, what suggestion you want to give me, or what upcoming videos you want to see in my channel. Thank you guys.